And this is not the start of the summer school. This is preschool. Preschool. Okay? And this is what I call the International Summer School Starter Kit. And it's really designed for those of you who may have had very little or none experience working with the at an international level with the trade union movement. But I can also see in the audience there's a good scattering of people who have probably more experience than I have of the international trade union movement. So they've come to keep an eye on me and probably correct me when I make mistakes. Okay. This is very informal. If you don't understand something I say, if you don't hear me properly, if you want to ask a question, then just interrupt me. Just shout out and we'll do that. All the practical things and proper introductions and so on we'll do after lunch when we have the proper opening. So this is just like a little bit of a warm-up on the international trade union movement. Okay. First thing I want to talk about is these things called global unions. And you might have heard people talking about global unions, or in really what they should be called is international trade union federations. They are federations of unions around the world. And through our subscriptions to our unions, the fees that we pay, a small amount of that goes to these international organizations of which we are affiliated. Our unions are members of these international organizations. And there are two sorts of global unions. One is what we call the global union federations, and the other is for the moment, I'll just describe it as being the International Trade Union Confederation. But I'll explain these things in more detail. So, first of all, global union federations. Now, these are based on the industry in which you work or the sector in which you're employed. And they are paid directly from your unions who join them to those global union federations. And at the moment, these are the major global union federations. I say at the moment because from year to year it changes, mostly as global union federations decide to merge or work together more closely and so on. So these are the main ones. So we have the Building and Woodworkers International, which quite a few of you are from unions of our members of the Building and Woodworkers International. Now there's a rule, by the way, about phones. Right? When phones go off in session, right, it means that you have to buy everybody a drink, right, in the evening. Right? So if I were you, unless you're very rich, right, or very generous, switch your phones off or switch them to silent. Okay, so the Building and Woodworkers International is really the union that deals with the construction industry all over the world. So if your union is a construction workers union, or part of your union is responsible for construction workers, you would be a member of BWI. Then you have Education International, which is the federation of all the teaching unions around the world. Then you have a rather strangely titled one called Industrial. And this is set up to be basically the super federation of manufacturing and private sector, in the private sector. And it came about from 2-3 years ago now, a merger between three other smaller federations. You had the International Chemical, Energy and Mine Workers Federation, the International Metal Workers Federation, and the International Textile, Garment and Leather Workers Federation. And they thought it would be a good idea to merge and come together to form one big, hopefully powerful, union around manufacturing. Then you've got the International Federation of Journalists, which is actually quite small, but it covers journalist unions all over the world. The International Transport Workers Federation, obvious, transport unions all over the world, civil aviation, shipping, road, you name it. The International Union of Food Workers, talk a bit more about them. It's actually not just what we narrowly define as food, it includes agriculture and hotels and tourism and other things. We have Public Services International, which is public sector unions, government employees, local government, and so on. And finally, one called Union Network International, which again was a merger between a whole number of smaller organizations some years ago. And that includes all the private sector services. So it's things like banking, finance, IT, telecommunications, post. What am I missing?
Janitorial.
Security, yeah. All those sort of unions. All over.
Call centers? Call centers?
Call centers, yes. Absolutely. That would be part of UNI. All right? These are, each one of these is independently governed and managed. So they are democratic organizations. Every 3, 4, 5 years, whatever, they have a conference, big conference, international conference, where delegates from all the unions that are affiliated to them come together. They elect a leadership, they elect an executive, they determine policy, and so on and so forth. We'll talk a little bit more about what they actually do. And if you, in general, want a sense of what the global unions are doing and what they're about, there is a website called Global Unions. You can Google it, find it very easily. And that is a portal, in effect, to all the global union federations. So if you want to find out more about that, about global union federations, that's the best place to start. Right? And it also carries news which are drawn from all the global union federations on campaigns and struggles and disputes and stuff that they're involved in. Just to give you some more detail and some examples, focusing on the three global union federations that are actively involved in supporting this summer school, and from which you, many of you, come. So first of all, we have the IUF, which is the International Union of Food Workers. Its full title, if you can remember, and very few people can, is the International Union of Food, Agriculture, Hotel, Restaurant, Catering, Tobacco, and Allied Workers Associations. And Dan, put your hand up, Dan. <laughs> 29 years. So he knows everything about the history of the IUF, if you're interested in finding out more. It was founded in 1920. At the moment, it has approximately 336 affiliated trade unions from 120 countries. And if you add up all the membership of all the unions that are affiliated, you reckon they're covering 12 million workers. And they're based, like many other of the global union organizations, in Geneva. This is the second one I'm focusing on, the International Transport Workers Federation, which some of you are from, including me. My union is part of the International Transport Workers Federation. In fact, my union, I'm from Unite in the UK. It's a big general union. Right? We cover all sorts of different sectors. And in fact, we are affiliated to nearly every single one of the global union federations, because we've got workers in every different sector, apart from education, journalism, and a couple of others. So we're part of the ITF as well. The ITF is unique in that it's based in London, and it organizes, as it says, seafarers, dock workers, civil aviation workers, railway workers, road transport, urban transport, fisheries, and a little bit of tourism, which shares with the International Union of Food Workers. And they claim to have something like 681 unions affiliated. It's very big, representing 4.5 million workers in 148 different countries.
Sorry, can I just ask a question?
Yes.
You know what, when you say United affiliated to that,
yeah,
you only count the members of United Wellness Industries then?
That's a good question. When a union like Unite, a big union, we have 1.6, I think, theoretically, 1.5, let's say 1.5 million members of Unite in the UK, right? But we only have, let's say, 50,000 transport workers. So these figures do not include, only include the 50,000 that we declare to the ITF, because the ITF would say to us, how many do you have in the transport industry? And we would say 50,000. And then we would pay dues for 150,000 members. Now, in fact, it's very political, because the more members that you claim that you've got in the sector, the more money you have to pay. So you'll find a lot of unions will tell the international, the Global Union Federation, that they've got far fewer members. Okay, and then we have the Building and Woodworkers International, again based in Geneva. It organises in building materials, wood and forestry. And at the moment, is this right, Jin Suk? I think 350 unions representing 12 million members in 135 countries. Jin Suk works for the Building and Woodworkers International, so she can tell you a lot more detail about what BWI does. Now, what do they do? Well, I think these days, first and foremost, their main task is to support international organizing. More and more people are either working directly for transnational corporations, or they're working in industries which are more and more globally integrated. So you may be working in a factory in London or in Brazil or in South Korea or wherever, but increasingly for you to be effective as a union representative in those in your local workplace, you have to know what you're doing, what's happening in your company or in your industry in many other countries. Because obviously they're making decisions will be made in New York or in Paris or in Beijing, which have direct influence on your members' terms and conditions and jobs and security and so on. So increasingly over the last 20 years, we'll be talking a lot more about this, but increasingly global union federations are having to take the role of supporting unions who want to start organizing on an international basis. And that primarily means bringing representatives together of different local unions who are working in the same company or the same industry on a global basis or a regional basis to work out how they can coordinate their activities. So, for example, last year I was doing some work with the International Union of Food Workers, and we had a meeting, a global meeting, of shop stewards, local representatives from a brewery company called AB InBev. I don't know if you've ever heard of AB InBev, but it's the biggest brewery in the world, right? It's covered, and it's most, the beer is awful, I might add. And it's really interesting. None of the workers like the beer either that we met. Anyway, we brought together, I think 50 or so people from around the world who were representing workers in the different brewery, different plants and different breweries, wherever we could find there were unions that were representing, to try and come together to coordinate what we knew about the company, what was its global strategy, and what should we do internationally as a union movement. Now, these global unions are not large organizations. BWI, how many staff does BWI have? So 13 people in Geneva. Then you have other people in the in the regional offices. 50 people, right? It's not very many. So you imagine, like in the construction industry, where you have whole number of global construction companies, right? And they've got, the management have got hundreds and hundreds of people working. A global level. So it's increasingly not the global union federations that do it themselves, it is affiliates, it is unions at the national level who come together and work as a network, right? Rather than depend on a sort of hierarchy, they actually work horizontally between them, and the global union federations encourage them to work and network and email and Facebook and Twitter and meetings and solidarity actions and all those things happen between the unions working that level. Okay, they also coordinate solidarity actions. So when a union is facing a really big problem, maybe I'll give an example from the IUF recently, the company Nestle, everybody's heard of Nestle, there was a plant in Indonesia where a group of workers joined the union, and they tried to organize a union, and they were all sacked. They were all fired and thrown out of the factory. And the union called for help from the International Union of Food Workers, and they organized a big campaign in support of those workers in Indonesia, and eventually forced Nestle at a top level to negotiate, and eventually they won. And those workers were taken back into the factory, and the union is now in place in that factory in Nestle. That's a good story. There's many stories which don't work so happily, but that's a major part of what global unions have to do, is to coordinate solidarity actions for unions in trouble. Then there's a more general work it does around what I'd call trade union development and education, particularly for unions in the developing world or in East Europe and so on. Unions that are maybe weak, small, they need help. They need resources, they need expertise, they need training, they need support. So a lot of the work that they do is to help unions develop and build education and training programs and help them build organizers and so on and so forth. Some of that is supported with money that comes from outside the trade union movement. So there's a few countries in the world, just a few, like Norway, like Denmark, like Sweden, like Canada, like the Netherlands, and a few others, where the governments agree to pay money to the international trade union movement to help develop the democratic trade union movements in primarily the global south. They also represent workers' interests on a whole number of bodies, United Nations organizations and international employers associations and so on. So, for example, the International Transport Workers Federation, they will be representing transport workers on the International Maritime Organization that governs the rules for the sea, or the International Civil Aviation Authority, which determines how the civil aviation system works, or at special discussions at the International Labour Organization of the UN, which I'll come on to in a minute. So they do a lot of representation of us at a global level. They do campaigns on certain key issues, whether it be things like health and safety, or whether it be time at work, or women's rights, or whatever it might be, whatever seems to be the priority. They do research on key subjects, on industries, on companies. And finally, of course, they facilitate information exchange between unions around the world. So broadly, that's what the Global Union Federation.
Sorry, I just asked the last question.
Yeah.
Is there no Global Union about arts and culture?
There is. No, that's within uni. There was a separate international federation called MEI, Media and Entertainment International, and that covered things like musicians, actors,
television
production, camera operators, all those sort of things, culture and media. And that was the part of the merger that became Union Network International. So for museums and art galleries, I'm not sure. It would either be under Public Services International or Uni.
My second question is, you know, you said they represent us at the UN and international level.
Yeah.
As engaging with this TTIP, like transatlantic.
Very good question. And it's now becoming a growing campaign against TTIP around the world. We will be just, I'm sure, we'll be talking about that during the week, because it's a very big issue. Do people know what we're talking about? This new transatlantic trade agreement, which is threatening big problems. Okay. The ITUC is a federation of national centres. Now, national centres mean different things in different countries. Here in Britain, we only have one. It's called the Trades Union Congress, the TUC. In other countries, you might have 2, 3, 6, 20 national trade union centres. In other words, bringing together unions in a national federation. And the ITUC is the primary international federation of national union federations. Yeah. In British terms, you describe it as the global TUC of all the TUCs. It was founded in 2006 as a merger between two others, which I'll talk about a bit in a minute. It's based in Brussels, and it represents national trade union centres. So it came from, and this is important to know, it came from two slightly smaller federations. One was called the International Confederation of Free Trade Unions, the ICFTU, which goes back to 1949, and basically was a federation of national trade union federations that were broadly social democratic or democratic socialist in character. Quite a wide range, but broadly that sort of social democratic socialism view. Then there was also the World Confederation of Labour, which goes back to 1920 and was primarily Catholic, Christian Catholic in its composition. For those in the UK, this may be a strange concept, the idea of a religious-based union. But in many countries around the world, there are unions which are Catholic or Christian unions, like in the Netherlands, in Dan, is there a French Christian union?
Yes, basically a right-wing fundamentalist club that refused to deconfessionalize.
Okay. By the way, Dan is a walking encyclopedia on international trade union history. It's very, very rarely I ask him a question he doesn't know the answer to. Okay, so they came together a few years ago to form the ITUC. And basically, a lot of the World Confederation of Labour unions, although they have the title Christian, many of them traditionally were Christian, but really were very little different to the unions of the rest of the world. ITUC, hello Joshua, thank you. Which I'll talk about a little bit more in a minute. So, what is the ITUC for? What does the ITUC do? Well, first and foremost, it represents the trade union interests at the international government level. So in the same way as here in the UK, our TUC is responsible for negotiating with the British government on questions around labour law, employment, and so on and so forth. The ITUC does that at an international level with organisations like the World Trade Organization, the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, and most of all, I'll come on to that in a moment, the International Labour Organization. So they are our political, quote unquote, representatives. As the global union federations, they are about the unions in their sector, right, specifically. This is very much more broad. They also coordinate solidarity action against trade union repression, particularly when you have the repression of trade unions by governments. So it might be places, in the past, and other countries where there is, you know, government repression, state repression of trade union rights. It also does a lot of research work. It also does union development work. Similarly, it helps unions, national centres build and develop and so on. And it has an overall policy emphasis on what it calls decent work. Right. You will come across this term a lot in the international trade union movement. We demand decent work. Right. It actually comes from the International Labour Organization. I'll come on to that in a minute. But decent work basically means what when you have a stable job, when you have predictable income, you know that your employer is not going to disappear tomorrow. It means that you have rights to join the trade union and to collective bargaining and all those things. It means that you have what they call social protection, like pensions, health care, social security. You add all of these things up together, right, and they call that decent work. Now, last year I was doing some work with the International Transport Workers Federation, and I was writing a pamphlet about precarious work, which we'll come on to. And precarious work is not decent work, right? But to start explaining what we meant by precarious work, I had to try and find a way of explaining decent work. So I tried to find an example of a worker somewhere in the world who had got decent work, right, within the transport industry. So I started phoning unions around and emailing around. And first of all, I thought, Australia's a great place, right? They're railway workers. They must have fantastic, you know, really good conditions. So I wrote to the Australian railway workers and I said, you know, do you have an example of somebody who's got everything in terms of what we would call decent work? And they said, no. our social protection is being cut. We're being threatened with privatization. No, that doesn't work. So I had to go around the world. India, I thought, India Railways, they are world famous for being this incredibly fantastic organization with one of, if not the largest trade union in the world, the Indian Railway Workers. Surely they will have decent, no privatization, zero-hour contracts, de-skilling, oh, you name it. You know, it's all happening within the Indian Railways. But I found one, right? I found Finland. Right, and I was assured that in Finland, a railway driver has got decent work. But the point I'm making is that the struggle for decent work is not as if, you know, like half the world's working population has got decent work and half hasn't. It's an aspiration. It's out there. It's what they strive towards. Now, there is also the World Federation of trade unions. And this was basically has its roots in the Communist Party back in the early parts of the Soviet Union. And it was basically the Red Unions, as they described it. And although I won't, again, Dan has got everything on the history of this, but Prague, and its unions, that were members of it, were primarily those of the Soviet bloc, plus Cuba, Vietnam, and other places around the world, but primarily the core socialist bloc. Now, of course, after the Berlin Wall fell down and the Communist Party regimes collapsed, so did those unions. So in every country, that's not quite true, but in most countries in the former Soviet Union and elsewhere, workers, in one way or another, attempted to seize those old not. But basically, the whole structure, in effect, collapsed, right, at a world level. But, and it was used to be based in Prague. But more recently, it has beginning to try and reassert itself again. And it's moved its headquarters to Athens, because there is still, in Greece, a very large Communist Party-controlled trade union movement, which is old style. I mean, it really is old style. Dan and I went to a demonstration in Athens last spring, was it, Dan?
Yes.
There was a general strike in Greece, and we were invited to be in Athens, and we were standing in the square in the middle of Athens, where the demonstrations, when workers are demonstrated, they all arrive at this square. Right, so we were standing in the square waiting to see the demonstrations of workers arrive. And after a while, down the street, right towards us, comes this big procession of workers, all holding red flags, walking in absolute discipline, right, singing songs. Most of them were men. Most of them were age 50 and onwards, right, but very disciplined, very disciplined. But thousands of them. Right, and they marched down, and they shouted their slogans and sang their songs, and then they dispersed. Right, and that was the Communist Party union structure in Greece. After they'd gone, half an hour later, another demonstration arrived. Some of you might have heard of the political party called Syriza, yeah, which is the sort of new green left coalition, so on and so forth. And this was primarily the Syriza demonstration. It was twice the size, and it was everything you can possibly imagine. To women, lots of young people. And they had simply sewn into the corner of their banners the Syriza symbol. So it's their own banner, but with the Syriza symbol in the corner. And it was a very vivid visual, for me, gave an understanding of the huge difference between those two traditions, the Communist Party tradition and, the New Left tradition that's struggling in Greece. There's a question about whether or not the World Federation of Trade Unions is having a resurgence, whether it's coming back. And it's trying, to a certain extent, reinvent itself to distance itself from its old Stalinist past and re-establish itself as a reputation as being the federation that represents those who believe in class politics, basically. And we will talk about this a lot more during the week, but there are some that argue, including me, that the ITUC is so bland politically, it says very little about politics. It asks for decent work, not much more, right, that there's a vacuum, and that there's many unions around the world who are, or unionists, union activists, who are angry about what's going on. They want an alternative to what's going on, and some are beginning to think, well, maybe we should become part of the WFTU. They say that we're fighting for class politics. We're not, we're anti federation, the Confederation of South African Trade Unions, CASATU. Very big, very influential, very powerful, an extraordinary history. And they voted recently, last year, was it, I think, to affiliate to the WFDU. And that gave a really big impulse to the WFDU to become, to try and re-emerge. And here in this country, you've all got RMT bags, I think, an RMT green, that is a rail union in the UK. They have voted to affiliate to the WFDU. Yes, Sam?
Can you go ahead and vote?
Ah, very good question. When Kasatu affiliated to the WFDU, they wanted to retain their affiliation to both ITUC and WFDU. As far as I know, it's still under discussion. Does anybody know more recently? Lenny?
They sold their position. They decided they could join the WFDU, but they retained membership of ITUC.
It's whether or not the ITUC agrees with that. Okay. There was, I think the motion was passed to explore affiliation at Kasatu, yes. Anyway, this is a photograph of Kasatu members in South Africa during a union meeting waving WFDU banners to try and encourage the Kasatu to join the WFDU. We shouldn't forget that all these organizations have regional as well as global structures. I won't say too much about that, but there are most of the global union federations and, of course, the ITUC. They have Latin American, African, Asian, East European, and West European trade union structures, some of which, particularly Europe, are problematic because sometimes the regional structures have different policies and different ideas to the global structures, and you get a lot of tension sometimes between the regions and the global organizations. It's also worth mentioning that for some, at least, of the global unions, one of the biggest areas of growth has been the Middle East in terms of the fallout from the so-called Arab Spring and the development of independent unions in a whole number of countries in the Middle East, Arab-speaking countries. And so there's now a lot of emphasis being put on building those unions in the Arab-speaking world. I just want to say a little bit about the International Labour Organization, the ILO, because people will refer to the ILO during our discussions, and maybe you don't know what the ILO is. This is a photograph from what's called the International Labour Conference, which is the governing body of the International Labour Organization, which is, in turn, I think the earliest formation of the United Nations. The ILO was created in 1919. Any idea why? Somebody said the First World War, I think. Yes, that's true. But Sujata says the Russian Revolution. Exactly right. That's why it was formed. Because after the Bolsheviks took power in Russia, and there was the prospect of the spread of communism around the world, Western, as it were, governments and around the world, then communism would spread. So they formed the International Labour Organization to establish rules, international rules and regulations, which are technically called conventions, but I'll come on to that in a moment. I think it's a fascinating organization. Most people find it deadly boring. I don't. I think it's interesting. To me, it is basically a theatre of class warfare. Okay, this is the conference, and On the right-hand side down here, right, this block of people here with 25% of the seats and 25% of the votes are representatives of employers. Okay. On the left-hand side over here, we're 25% of the seats and 25% of the votes are the workers' representatives, trade unionists, right? And your leaders of your own unions will be sitting in that block of people. And in the middle, these are all government representatives. So 50% of the vote is with the governments, 25% employers, 25% workers, workers' organizations, unions. And what they do is they come together and generally, it's every year held in Geneva, it's a big thing, costs a lot of money. Every year, the workers will sit down and say, we think we need new regulations. Right. So at the beginning of the conference, they will stand up and they will make a speech and say, we demand maternity leave for all women workers. Right. And then the employers will stand up and we say, we oppose maternity leave for all, women workers. And then governments start standing up and down and making statements, and eventually there's a vote. Now, in fact, it's a very much more complicated. With the workers. And other times they will vote with the employers. There are even times when employers have supported workers and vice versa. But that's rare. but we'll be talking about some of that later on this week. Particularly, you may have heard that 2 years ago, was it? When was the domestic workers? 2011. There was a new convention, a new set of rules that were agreed by the ILO covering domestic workers for the first time.
Yes, migrants.
Migrant workers.
Yeah, what do the votes actually mean in terms of enforcement?
Ah, very good point. Okay, so they agree a new international law, right? A new regulation, but that in itself, it doesn't mean anything. What has to happen after that is that governments individually then have to bring that law into their own legal structure. Is just the beginning of the battle. The next stage of the battle is that you have to get the governments to ratify that and bring it into their own legislation. But what happens if a government goes against a convention, right? For example, there are big conventions on, well, let's say maternity leave. You know, if you took, there is a convention on maternity leave, I'm sure. if a government refuses to enable workers to have maternity leave, what can be done? Well, the trouble is that the ILO has no police force, it has no army. Right, it can't threaten nuclear Armageddon if you don't agree to these. All it can actually really do is diplomatically to embarrass them. Right, and so if there's a huge process that goes on before that, but if a country is seen and proved to be breaking a key convention to which they have ratified, signed up, and so on, then at some point in the conference, somebody will stand up and deliver a speech which will embarrass that government and say, you know, they've been very, very naughty boys and girls. Okay, but it does have effect, believe you me. The governments do not like being criticized within the ILO. And for example, China, which has probably the worst on a scale, mass scale, worst labor rights record, it really goes to a great length to try and avoid being embarrassed by the ILO. there are hundreds of different conventions, right? Hundreds of different rules and laws that the ILO has produced. And a few years ago, they said, well, hold on, there must be some of these which were more important than anything else. And they called these the core labor standards. And these are conventions, they're labor standards, where even if a country has not ratified them, they are supposed to uphold. Right? And it's a very interesting discussion, and I do, when I'm working with, when I'm teaching British trade unionists, I give them an exercise. I say, right, go away and think of, if you had to choose five key issues that you regard to be core, absolutely central to workers' rights, what would they be? And people say, well, you know, decent wage? No. The right to strike? No. What else might it be? But actually, these are the ones that were thought to be so fundamental, right, that the ILO agreed that these should be the core labour standards. And those are freedom of association, which is the right to be in a union, the right to collective bargaining. So if you are a union, the employer has to be collective bargaining with you. The elimination of forced labour, like prison labour and so on, which is seen as being absolutely beyond the decency, as it were. The effective abolition of child labour. Notice the difference in language. So elimination of forced labour, but the effective abolition of child labour, because it's recognised that it is an incredible problem to get rid of. And finally, freedom from discrimination, whether it be gender, whether it be religion, whether it be race, and so on. So those are the core labour standards, which upon which a lot is built, which we'll discuss later in the week. And that sort of is the core of what the ILO and the ITUC would regard as being decent work.
How many of these principles are in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights?
Good question, don't know. The question was, how many of these principles are actually embodied in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights?
Well, collective bargaining, I don't think it is.
Freedom of association. Some are even explicitly mentioned other conventions, not the ILO, for example, the right to strike,
right,
which is exists in United Nations and European Union statements,
right,
but not in the ILO.
Okay. That's a quick overview of the main institutions. By the way, sometimes gets confused. It is not a trade union body. It is primarily a government body, but there are trade unions have the right of 25% of the vote. That's what it is. Okay, so if you were, as many people in this room do, if you were to be going to an international trade union conference, one form or another, maybe of your global union federation, and you're in the bar or in the restaurant in the evening, what are the key debates and discussions that people are having? And there's some key questions or agenda items for discussion that you'll find being talked about a lot. And we will be talking about quite a lot this week. But just to give you a little introduction. So first of all, what some people are called new capitalism. We all know about the bank crises. We know about the economic crises reverberating around the world recently. And there are some people, and we'll hear about this this afternoon and tomorrow and so on, about the impact of what is called financialization. I won't go into that in detail, but basically it's what happens when companies who normally produce stuff, right, simply become banks. So they just have a big wad of money, right, rather than assets, and they will just put that money where it can get the greatest return, even if it's got nothing to do with what their original core business was. So, for example, General Motors, right, you think of as being producing cars. Well, actually, they make just as much money out of selling credit cards. Right? It's that sort of what happens when a corporation becomes, in effect, a bank. But that's a very crude way of describing it, but we'll be talking about it later in the week. Because this has enormous implications for members of trade unions around the world, about the way that companies move money around and so on. The second is what I call the problem with Europe. And there are two sides to this. One is those of us who are European will be very familiar with the problem that all over Europe there are rising numbers of people who are critical of the European project, who are in some cases wishing to leave their country to leave the European Union. Mostly from a very right-wing perspective, but sometimes not, sometimes from the left. And so on the big geopolitical stage, there is a big debate, including within the trade union movement, about the future of Europe and whether or not we should be in or out of Europe, particularly here in the UK. But it has a specific problem for the trade union movement, because the regional structures of the trade union movements at a European level are absolutely hand in hand with the European Commission and the European project of a greater confederated Europe. And most of, if not all of, the European trade union structures are dependent upon European Commission finances, particularly for the cost of meetings. You know, the biggest cost for any international union is the cost of meetings. That's what you really do most of the time. And a lot of that is the cost of interpretation. If you and you need hotels, travel, and all the rest of it. This is expensive. Right? And a lot of that is paid for by the European Commission. However, this was all developed 20, 30 years ago when, in broad terms, Europe as an institution was a social democratic place. And unions, for example, here in the UK, when we at the time were facing Margaret Thatcher in an attack on the union movement, we found friends, people within the Brussels system, were very sympathetic to a social democratic trade union movement being encouraged in Europe. So all of these structures were set up at that time. However, in the last 10, 20 years, Europe has shifted to the right and now holds basically a majority of political control and is no longer pro-union. However, the European structures within Europe remain dependent, right, on the European institutions. And this is causing big problems for everybody. Why do I mention Europe in particular? I could talk about other regions, you know, Asia and Africa and so on and so forth, because we're from all over the world. But you must remember throughout that still today, even though there's been a decline in European membership in Europe over in Europe still are much stronger than other regions of the world. Still, it is dominates the politics of the international trade union movement. But because of this problem, this is becoming very questionable, and this is going to have an impact on everybody. Evidently, big issues for the trade union movement around climate change, energy, and so on and so forth. I won't say very much, I think it's self-evident. This is a big area of debate and discussion. We'll be leading a discussion about climate change and the trade union movement. Anti-capitalism.
Yes.
I think a lot of trade unions have a problem with this. If they, when they see demos, you know, like Occupy movement, they see younger people having far more radical anti-capitalist ideas and creating movements which are separate from the trade union movement, demanding far more radical political change, how does the trade union movement react to that?
Cautious.
Yes, at best. I mean, some unions absolutely embrace it. Very interestingly, my own union, Unite, when our General Secretary, Lenny McCluskey, he went down to visit the Occupy London site, and he came back absolutely, not transformed, but he became back absolutely inspired. He said, right, we need to do this. We need to do this. And these two guys sitting here, doing all this stuff which you can't see, which is our social media, the rest of it, their organization, Union Solidarity International, is a direct response to that. Because Lenny McCluskey, our General Secretary, saw the vibrancy and inspirational quality of the Occupy movement, and in particular the use of social media and so on, and he said, right, we buy into that, we need to do that. But other union leaders in different parts of the world, including UK, are far more cautious or conservative, or indeed, they are not anti-capitalist. You know, they don't think that our job is to challenge capitalism. And I think that debate is going to grow as time goes on, is are we or are we not? Now, I think most people in this room would say we are. Hope so, otherwise we've selected you very badly. but we are not necessarily in the majority. Okay. Next one, sorry, I'm talking so long, I probably should stop soon. The next question is around the future of public services. I don't know about the countries that you come from, but the country I come from, the level of attack on public services is not simply something which is, you know, shaving a few pounds off and getting rid of a few members of staff and so on. It is a fundamental restructuring. And it's not, some trade union leaders in this country, for example, would argue that it's okay, all we need is to get another government in, a Labour government maybe, and they will reverse all these cuts and we'll go back to where it was. No, it's not true. The attack on public services is a global attack. It is led by corporations who want to get into the market currently occupied by public sector. What do we do? We, of course, say no to the cuts. We, of course, say no to austerity. We, of course, argue against job losses and so on and so forth. But this is defensive, and we're moving backwards. What's our alternative? What do we think that public services should look like? How do we articulate that? How do we build... be looking at something, new models of the way that public services are delivered. Then there's the rise of what we call precarious work. For those from the Global South and elsewhere, this will be not very new, much news at all, but in Europe, United States, Canada, the old OECD countries around the world, where since the Second World War, basically, workers have enjoyed relatively pretty good conditions in terms of social protection, job security, and so on and so on and so forth. That is going fast. And so we now got the whole rise across the world, and it's a global phenomenon of outsourcing, privatization, zero-hour contracts, temporary work, you name it. And so jobs are becoming, I think in Germany you call them mini jobs, don't you?
No, that's separate, but it's part of it, yeah.
The nature of work itself is changing. I mean, the obvious thing is, my father, when he was working, started work at the age of whatever time he left college, the age of 22 or something, and he worked throughout his life until he was 65, until, in fact, until he was 60, and had a very nice pension, and was fine. Now, my children, who are in their mid-20s, I doubt whether or not they're going to have anything like that. They're going to have periods of short-term contracts, they're going to have temporary work, they may be working part-time, they may be self-employed, they may go back into retraining, they may be unemployed for a bit. It's going to be a real mixture. So how do we organise those workers? How do we organise those workers? And that's why we've got people like Kendall. Where's Kendall? Yeah, this is why we've invited people like Kendall from SEIU in the United States. And Kendall's job is to organise amongst fast food workers, which are some of the most precarious workers in the world. And so we'd be very interested, we're looking forward to hearing what he says about that. But all the global unions are talking about precarious work and what do we do about it and how do we resist it and so on. It's become a very big topic of conversation. I can tell you a very interesting story about this photograph, but I don't think I've got time. This is, you know, the chocolate company called Hershey's in the States, right? They produce chocolate, and they had a plant in Mississippi? No. Minneapolis? No. Anyway, it's a factory somewhere in the States, can't remember where. And they then subcontracted the entire factory to DHL, the logistics company. Right? And DHL said, fine, we'll run the whole factory for you. Right? And so that Hershey's had no responsibility for any worker in that plant. Right? DHL moved in. They then subcontracted the entire labor supply to a labor supply company, a temporary work agency. Right? The temporary work agency then subcontracted to a non-profit, so-called, company that specialized in student exchanges. Right? And so they brought students in from all over the world, right? Paid nothing for so-called work experience. So people came in from all over the world thinking they're going to have a really good, and they would just find themselves working in a chocolate factory. That was it, right? Anyway, these students, these are the students, and also they were captive. They couldn't move because their visas into the United States were dependent on the job they had in the chocolate factory. Right? So they went on strike. And had a massive battle, and I think the SEIU came in big time to support them, and they won, and the company was taken to court, and they won, and so on and so forth. But that is just, for me, an extraordinary work, but downright informal work, where you have no rights whatsoever, where you are have no form of social protection, you are either having to struggle as a sort of officially self-employed, but basically you're just trying to seek a living, or you're working in informal workplaces, you know, sweatshops and so on and so forth. So that's the worst levels of conditions are to be found in informal workers who, in some countries in the world, particularly in Africa, can account for up to 90% of the workforce. I mean, this is huge numbers. And those of you who've been in, I don't know, cities like Lusaka or wherever it might be, you will see, you know, you'll be used to seeing lots of people on the streets just simply trying to make money, whatever they can, to feed themselves that day. And it's rising. It's going, the number of people who are having to work in the informal economy is rising all the time. And there are several of us around this room who have some experience working around informal economy stuff, and we will be discussing it during the week. Then there's a big question about how do you rebuild the trade union movement? Gone are the days when a union official in a suit could go and knock on the door of a factory and talk to the manager and say, hello, I'm from the union, I'd like to sign up your members, please. I'd like all to be members. And the manager said, oh, that sounds perfectly reasonable to me, yes, fine. You can have total access and so on. And without the workers even knowing, they were suddenly part of a union. Right? Those days are gone. And we're now talking about how do you do it bottom upwards. And I've just got, just on the screen there, I've thrown some very varied examples, ranging from the, you know, the factory occupation movement in Greece at the moment, the work that our own union is doing about community membership, vendors, market traders. You've got organizations in Nepal, for example, of informal transport workers and all sorts of other things. Initiatives are built from the bottom upwards to rebuild unions and, in fact, rediscover what unions were originally. If you think back to the origin of the trade union movement, everybody was informal. You know, it's before you had any protection, before you had any rights, everybody was informal. And it was only those workers getting together and building upwards that created the trade union movement. We'll also be talking about the international organizing agenda. Oh, what's the time, by the way? I'm talking far too long. It's 10 past 12. Right, okay. And I apologize. But over organizing. So it started off in the 1970s, I would argue, when really what we now call globalization really started to kick in. For example, in the car industry, those sort of industries. And some of the global union federations began, chemical industries, whatever it might be. And some of those global unions at the time began to bring workers together from the same company, in what they called World Company Councils. That developed in the 1980s, especially with the advent of the internet and other computer communications, the idea of networks began to develop. By the 1990s, global unions began to sign global agreements. And that was unheard of before, where a global corporation would recognize and negotiate with a union at a global level. And the first one was actually signed, I think, by Dan with a company called Danone, which you may have heard of, makes dairy products and so on, French company. And the IOF signed the first what's called International Framework Agreement with Danone. However, as time has gone on, there are now dozens and dozens of these signed agreements, but some of them are a bit dodgy. Some of them are more like sort of PR exercises for the company. You know, they say, "Oh, look, you know, what do you mean we have no problems? We've signed an agreement with the unions. They think we're fine. Why? What's the problem down in that plant?" And so you've got a bit of a problem around that, which we'll talk about. And finally, more recently, is a sort of new agenda of organizing on a global basis. And how do we strategically look at an industry or a company and say, right, what do we need to actually have this company organized at a global level? And we'll be talking about that in more detail. Finally, is it finally? No, not quite finally. I suppose the original reason why we decided to have these summer schools was to have a discussion about politics of the international trade union movement. Where are the politics? There is a crisis, a global crisis, in the relationship between trade unions and their traditional political allies, whether it be in this country between the trade union movement and the Labour Party, whether it be in Germany between the trade union movement and the Social Democratic Party, whether it be in Norway or Sweden or France or Spain, South Africa, huge tensions now between the ANC and the trade unions. In Brazil, tensions between the unions and the Workers' Party. And all over the world, you can hear these discussions going on because there are very, very few what we might call mainstream political parties, i.e. parties which have the chance of being elected at a national level, who don't adopt what we would call a neoliberal economic agenda. You know, they believe in privatization. They believe in opening up markets and so on and so forth. And inevitably, that is creating tensions with the trade union because it goes against the interests of the workers. So there's a crisis of politics, I think, and I think others in the GLI and elsewhere think, going on. That is why I think there's a resurgence going, potentially, interest in the world. Call a democratic socialist alternative. What would be all is about? And I'd just like to finish by reading a quote from Sharon Burrow, who, just to remind you, is the General Secretary of the ITUC, a former Australian, former trade union leader in Australia, from a teachers union, was she? Yeah, former teachers union. Now, the ITUC is not a radical organisation. It is not. It is very cautious. It generally uses very careful words. And this is Sharon Burrow quoted just a couple of years ago, or 18 months ago. And I'll read it to you. She said, "We are not only losing collective bargaining rights, we are now in a labour war, effectively across Europe, the US, and emerging democracies." Why? Because the old stakeholders who drove the neoliberal economic policies that would seem to be foul policies, the Washington consensus, if you like, are back in control. Now, this is after the banking crisis, and we thought, my God, this could be the end of capitalism. But no, it didn't quite happen. those same people got back in control. We thought the global financial crisis showed us a failed economic model. We were wrong. We have now a situation where we are largely engaged in what I can only describe as a labour war. Now, that language from the head of the ITUC is extraordinary. And it shows the depth of political crisis, I think, that we face in the international trade union. Okay, any questions, any thoughts, any challenges? Yes?
Can you just the definition of neoliberal economic policies?
I would love to, if I had a lot of time. I'll tell you what, though, is it Francesco? Let's stand up at the back. Francesco is working with us at the GLI in Manchester. He has, over the last few weeks, been developing very bravely, it's a very hard thing to do, a little political dictionary for this summer school, primarily for the summer school commission, which I'll explain when we meet this afternoon. And one of the things in the dictionary is neoliberalism, isn't it? Yes. So I'm going to let Francesco handle that this afternoon when he's talking about the commission.
there's a really quick definition.
Go on then, yeah.
The economist Ha Jun Chang says there's three main components of neoliberalism. One is privatization of public assets. Two is financial liberalization, so essentially like letting the market go free in terms of finance, like the City of London. And three is deregulation, so sectors that were previously highly regulated in terms of their working rights are then deregulated so that companies can do sort of what they want to do. So I think, those are seen as the three main crises. It's a lot more complicated than that. That's one definition.
Well, not just one. Yes.
Two things. There's another definition, which is it's capitalism on crack.
That's a much better definition than mine.
I wanted to offer a different historical point of view on the World Federation of Trade Unions, because it relates to the current dilemma that you raise. My read of history is the World Federation of Trade Unions was a result of World War II, and that the roots that you describe, correct, but that the Soviet bloc, the original World Federation of Trade Unions included the Congress of Industrial Organizations in the United States. And I believe the TUC And so the notion was, coming out of World War II, when the discussion of the US-Soviet-US alliance, that it was going to continue and that there'd be an international trade union form. When the Cold War was initiated, and I would argue the British and the US initiated it, there was a split in the global trade union movement. And out of that, the ICFTU ends up getting formed. And what's interesting, having been at the ICFTU Congress in 2000, figure out how to describe their own history. Because ultimately, by the 1980s and 90s, you start to see the introduction of new trade union formations, like OSATU, the CUT, and others, that had much more class struggle orientation that challenged the way that the ICFTU fought. And the ICFTU, I would argue, has been in a crisis ever since, even with this merger, which I think they thought was going to resolve the crisis. And then ultimately, the World Federation of Trade Union becomes a Soviet bloc formation, including union movements and countries that were allied with the Soviets. Thus, you have these strange formations out of the Arab world that were like tied with the Saad and others.
Like the Nasserite.
That's right. Yeah. That are in the World Federation Trade Union, but they have their own set of contradictions. Mm. And so I'm just saying that there was a particular moment when the World Federation of Trade Unions, when it was formed, was not simply the profit earned reinvented. It was something else.
Okay, this is Sam. Sam, next.
Just back to neoliberalism, in addition to the point about being capitalism on crack. The other point is that it's fundamentally about the defeat of the working class. And Adolf Reed described neoliberalism as capitalism without working class opposition.
Right. That's very good.
Yes, just a quick addition to the definition. I think Dan Gillian came up with one of the most brilliant definitions I've ever come up with. And that is, it's a political project.
Yes.
Precisely aimed at rolling back the gains of the labor movement.
That's right. Okay, yes.
Just coming back to this quote, I think it shows what's missing from the ITC, because she said, like, when we saw the global financial crisis, you know, it was like, revive itself, and that's what keep happening. Crisis happen, and then they are back with new things. And I think if we are naive enough to think, oh, that was a failed economic model, that's why.
Okay. Any others? I just want to say, in response to Bill's thing about point about the WFTU and the Cold War, I think this, we should have a longer discussion about this. My analysis is slightly different. My analysis says that and ultimately, it was whether or not, for example, the Global Union Federations, or the International Trade Secretariats, as they were called at the time, were to submit to the power, right, of an overall WFTU. Jointly, as it was. But the politics involved in the WFTU went back way before. And although a lot of people, including myself in the past, have tried have explained everything in terms of the Cold War, I don't think that's sufficient to understand actually what was going on. But it certainly was that the WFTU and the old ICFTU were deeply involved in that Cold War. The points. No? Oh, okay, was that helpful?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So hopefully you've got at least some ideas when people start talking about different initials and put your hand. Say, I don't understand that. Otherwise, it's no point. We must be open. Nobody's going to be frightened of you asking questions, apart from me. Okay. Let's break for lunch. We will be coming back here at 1:30 for the proper opening of the summer school.
Where is lunch?